Hello, everybody. I'm David with Personal Living Alert, and welcome to a new edition of On the Clock with Personal Living Alert. Today, we're going to talk to my friend Pat Waldron, the owner of Active Healthcare Solutions. That's a care management firm. And we're just going to get to know Pat and a little bit about what she does in the industry that she's in. So welcome, Pat. How are you today?
Good morning, David, and thank you very much for giving me this opportunity. And I'm doing very, very well, thank you.
Oh, I'm very glad to hear that. So, Pat, I always start off the interviews like this. What's your background? How did you get involved in being a care manager and things like that?
Well, actually, healthcare was a second career for me. I went to LPN school. When I was halfway through, I realized it wasn't going to be enough for me. So I went to LPN school during the day, RN school at night, and I very quickly graduated with my RN credentials. I worked in the home care industry for 28 years. I was the national director for Amedisys for all of their facility business all over the country. And I was also the National Director of Medicare Certified Home Health for Brookdale Senior Living. And I actually commuted in and out of Brentwood, Tennessee for a period of time doing that. Five and a half years ago, after identifying that there was a missing link, I decided to get involved in the geriatric care management business, thus taking my certification. And I am a certified care manager and a registered nurse with many years of experience.
Well, that's impressive. Definitely an expert, and I like that. So I've been in the senior industry for only for a short period of time. I didn't even know, and my folks are older. I mean, they're 80, 85 years old. I never heard of a care manager. What is a care manager? How do people find out about you? What do you do?
Well, a geriatric care manager is usually a licensed nurse or a social worker, and they specialize in the geriatric arena, and they are like a professional relative. They identify what the needs are for an individual or for a family, and then we go about making sure that those needs are met, and they deal with safety, mental status, health. If they have an electrical problem, we will find an electrician. We will assist the families who are remote and cannot get to their parents by attending doctor's visits when asked to make sure that they are getting the accurate information. Medication compliance is a very big thing. Psychosocial is a very good thing. And we advocate for them in every avenue that they have to live in.
So that's interesting. So just out of curiosity, most of your clients are local, but their families probably live out of town. Would that be a safe thing to say?
I'm going to say that it's probably about 75-25. 25% of them are living locally. The families are living locally, but they are very involved with their life, their business, their children, and they don't have the time to deal with a parent who is in their 80s, usually in declining health, and their needs are immense.
That's very interesting to me. How are you interacting with your clients now? I mean, you used to probably be able to go, like you said, go with them to the doctor in their houses and things like that. Now with the COVID-19, how are you interacting with your clients?
Well, Michael, I am so glad that in my early nursing career, I worked at North Broward Hospital in Pompano, and I was on the isolation floor when we were seeing AIDS patients, and we really didn't know what AIDS was, how to treat it, how to protect ourselves, how to take care of the patient appropriately. And I am so happy that I had that educational piece, because I know how indeed to protect myself and I know how to educate my clients. For instance, I have a wonderful client who is a Holocaust survivor, 90 years old, who lives in an independent living retirement community. And 2 weeks before the close down, as I was researching information on COVID, I told her I did not want her going to the dining room any longer, that she was going to eat meals in her apartment. And she indeed has done that. I'm so glad that I kept her away from harm's way, because she is such an exceptional human being with such a wonderful story to tell, David, about her life and how she survived. So my knowledge of isolation, the fact that I did have PPE, not a lot. I have some wonderful family members and friends that have made masks. And in fact, I try to give masks to my clients that are softer and easier for them to wear if and when they have to go out. We are doing telehealth meetings with doctors, and if there is an emergency, the doctor will see the patient in the office and I will take them, all of us wearing protective gear.
Yeah. I haven't done a lot of these interviews, but what I'm coming across is a familiar theme in the fact that friends, community, and family are really stepping up. Everybody I've spoken to so far, it's how are you getting supplies? Friends, family, and the community, just like you are. I mean, you even helped me out. Last time I saw you, you gave me a handful of masks so we can go out to the store and be safe, which we've used and truly appreciate. And, you know, like the Beatles said, you can buy with a little help from your friends. You know, it's that simple, I think, some days.
Well, I think that we, as we're hearing on TV and in the news, we are all in this together. And this is not something that is just going to go away because we wish it to go away, David. We are going to have to learn to live with dynamics like this and step forward and do what's best. I am hoping and praying that treatment vaccines are going to be fast to get to us, because I know some of the brilliant minds in the country are indeed working on it.
I would agree, and I have the same hopes that you do. For care managers, Pat, let me ask you, is there a national association? Are they, and if so, are they providing, what kind of guidance and support are they providing?
Well, I'm very proud to say that there are organizations. The organization that I belong to is the Aging Life Care Association, commonly known as ALCA, using the letters as an acronym. And it, without a doubt, is the most prestigious and the hardest exams to get certified. And yes, they are providing almost daily information to care managers on how to handle the clients, how to handle the stress, what the latest news is for working with the clients, how to keep them socially involved without being able to see people face to face. In fact, David, I called many people and asked that they make sure that they're keeping in touch with their relatives 2 to 3 times a week, because they're missing that piece of not being able to see them, especially the ones that are local. I also have engaged my relatives to write little notes to seniors. They're mailing me a box to them, and I'm going to take them. And they're more or less generic, you know, thinking about you today kind of thing. And I'm going to give them to the EDs to pass out at some of the assisted livings.
Wow, that's beautiful. It really, really is. So the clients that you're using now and you're visiting, what are they asking for most? How, you know, is there a common theme? Is it companionship? What are they asking for most?
Well, most of the clients that we see, some of them live in homes that are alone. Some of them have more challenging positions. A wife is in the home, not in good health, but her husband has dementia. We are trying to provide them with whatever lifelines we can, with services that are going to be able to assist them. In some cases, we have placed private duties, and we vet the private duties that we use through trusted, well-respected companies. And we place them in there for the least amount of time to provide the most amount of service. And that's working out well. I speak to my clients on the phone at least 2 to 3 times a week, and I have my cell phone by me. They can reach me anytime at all for just the simplest of questions, Michael, and that includes the families as well.
So what do you think has been the biggest challenge right now? I mean, you kind of went over some of that, but is there anything that you might have missed or you want to add to?
I think the biggest challenge is the lack of ability to be close to people. A lot of these seniors are, their life is so dramatically changed at 83, 85, 90. I've even had a 102-year-old.
Wow.
And they want to be involved with their families and their loved ones. And I think that it's extremely hard on both sides. I think it's hard for the families because they can't get to them. And I think that it's extremely hard on the clients. And seeing everyone who is wearing masks and gloves and gowns and getting their food in a styrofoam box just doesn't bring the same appealing nature to what they are accustomed to. But this too will pass in the manner that we know it right now. And I keep trying to provide them with the hope and the stimulation that it's going to be sooner as opposed to later.
I agree. And that kind of segues into my next question is, what do you think the new normal is going to be? When do you think we're going to get back to anything? I mean, you know, Fabiana, who you know, we've talked about, I mean, like, when are you going to be comfortable going to a movie theater and sitting next to somebody or to any kind of, say, a Broadway show and or any kind of live sporting event? I mean, what is the new normal? A restaurant? When is it going to happen? What do you think?
Well, David, what I personally believe, and I'm going to preface this with, I'm a small business owner. I am a geriatric age. And I've worked all my life very, very hard. I believe that what I do and what you do and what any working family does is the economy is exceptionally important to us. But if I take the economy and weigh it against life, I can't find that they are equal. The life of someone is much more important than the dollar of someone. And I want very much for everything to get back to the new normal as quickly as possible. What do I think that's going to be? I think that it is going to be somewhere halfway between what we once knew and what the worst of what we're experiencing. I think a lot of education has to come into it. And I think a lot of patience, Michael. We have to be patient with one another. We have to promote finding the research that we need. We need to learn to use local businesses so they can survive as much as possible. And that includes you and myself, David. It's the new normal is not going to be the old normal. I do not think people are going to rush to see the latest hot movie at the movie theater and feel comfortable. I think you will see in the future a lot of masks, and I think that you will see caution on part of the consumer.
I agree. I think it's very sad, but I agree 100%. I mean, going to a restaurant and your waiter comes up to you with a mask and gloves on and you can't go in to eat unless you've got a mask and gloves on. I mean, it's not the food that you go out for, it's a social experience. And that's what we're going to lose. And I don't know how you get it back, and if you do ever get it back.
I tend to agree with that. But again, I think that's when patience comes in. And I think education, and you as a person that's a medical professional, I think it's very, very important that you, David, are constantly informing your contacts, as I am. In fact, today I received a very interesting little guide on Facebook, and I am going to read to you what it says. It says that if one person is wearing a mask and the other person is unknown COVID positive, there's a 70% chance that that will be given to another person. If one person is wearing a mask, it drops to 5%. If both people are wearing a mask, it drops to 1.5%. So as, and I see a lot of millennials that, they don't want to do it. They don't think it's necessary. Well, it is necessary, David. And we're going to find out that that curve will not continue to go down until we are all in compliance with what the minds are telling us we need to do.
I couldn't agree more. I couldn't agree more. Pat, I just, you know, how do people get in touch with you if they need your services, or if they just want to ask you a question, get some advice and things like that? How would somebody get in touch with you?
Well, they can always reach me on my cell phone, which is 561-302-6496. We have a website, www.activehealthcaresolutionsllc.com. We also have a Facebook page under the same name. I will talk to anyone. We're not 100% for every call that we get, but if it's information that they need some guidance, we are always going to spend the minutes and give them that complimentary time to give them a lifeline. That would include services such as you, and I want you to see I'm wearing mine and haven't taken it off since you educated me.
I truly
because I live alone with a dog, and my dog's not going to call 911 if I need it. Placement, if the family is at their wit's end and it's not prudent that the person be able to live at home any longer, I have contacts that we can assist with that. And these are all vetted, wonderful people that really care about the clients that are entrusted to our care.
Perfect.
So we get referrals from doctors, lawyers, tradespeople, friends and neighbors, relatives, and business associates.
Perfect. All right. Well, Pat, I truly appreciate you chatting with me today. I found it to be very informative. And I took away a lot, and I just wanted to say thank you.
Well, I want to thank you again for the opportunity. I love what we do. I absolutely love my profession and the fact that Active Healthcare Solutions can make minute changes in people's lives that enhance the quality of their life. And of course, you do the same, providing your service. So thank you very much, David.
Thank you, and enjoy the rest of your day.
Thank you. You too, sir.